smoking.
Today he's being tested to see if his cancer has spread. He may be the one getting the test, but we both live with the results.
The people you love are worth quitting for. You can quit. For free help, call 1-800-QUIT-NOW.
You try to stay ahead of the mess, but scrubbing still takes time. Now there's Dawn Power Wash Dish Spray. It's the faster way to clean as you go. Just spray, wipe, and rinse. It cleans grease 5 times faster. Dawn Power Wash, now available in free and clear.
Join us tomorrow, everybody, because the star of the new Fantasy Island, Belmi Young, she's back to guest co-host.
It is so brave for Belmi to come back down here after what happened last time with the Sharks.
You did her dirty. Oh, just wait and see what we have in store for Belmi this time.
It wasn't on me.
It's going to be fun.
Happening now.
Local leaders say young adults are choosing not to get vaccinated, and that is becoming a problem. Coming up, the latest on the concerning rise in COVID-19 cases.
That's when she screamed, "He has a gun, Mom. He's got a gun."
Several witnesses taking the stand today in the Otis McCain trial, all saying they saw this shooting take place. We'll take you inside the courtroom. That's coming up.
We won't hit 100 degrees anytime soon, with a small chance for rain into the weekend. The news at 5 starts right now.
And first at 5, Bexar County seeing an increase in positive COVID-19 cases. Today, the 7-day average at 265. Total cases here, more than 230,000. As of Metro Health's latest update this afternoon, there are no new deaths to report.
And taking a look at our hospitals, there are 258 COVID positive patients being treated. 81 are in the ICU, 33 are on ventilators.
With that in mind and an increase in the positivity rate we told you about yesterday, local leaders say young people are putting themselves and others in jeopardy by not being vaccinated.
Today, city leaders and doctors gave an update on where Bexar County stands in the pandemic. Tiffany Huertas joins us live from a vaccine event with details of what was discussed.
Local leaders say more vaccinations are needed to bring down that concerning rise in cases and hospitalizations. But take a look at this video from today. This is officials holding a briefing this afternoon after data showed the positivity rate nearly doubled over the past week, jumping from 5.8% to 11.2%. Official says testing is down. At the height of the pandemic, they would test 60,000 people per week. City leaders say last week they just tested 8,600 people. Currently, hospitalization numbers are also up. 258 people are in our hospitals. More than 1 million people have been vaccinated in Bexar County. But Judge Wolf pointed to young people, saying they are the ones choosing not to get vaccinated, and that's becoming a problem.
One third or so of younger people are getting vaccinations, and we know that's where the problem is. And we're going to have to do everything we can to keep trying to convince them to do that. As the mayor said, it's so easy to get the vaccine.
Metro Health says 1 in 10 individuals who have received their first vaccine dose have not returned for their second dose. To be protected against COVID-19, you must have 2 shots of Pfizer and Moderna and be fully vaccinated. Officials are concerned that cases may grow with children returning to school in the fall. And coming up at 6, hear from a local doctor about what parents should know. Right now, officials kept repeating today that there are a lot of vaccines available. Right now, we are currently at St. Agnes Catholic Church on Roy Street. Remember, no appointments are needed, and you can just walk in and get your free shot. Tiffany Huertas, KSAT 12 News.
Thank you, Tiffany. And if you're looking for a chance to get vaccinated, there are 2 opportunities tomorrow. A vaccine event is going on from noon to 6 at Palo Alto College and from 3 to 7 at Southside High School. And with COVID cases surging in dozens of states, health experts say it's due to the Delta strain and unvaccinated people. And the push to get as many people vaccinated as possible remains at an uphill battle. Dara Forge has the latest.
Across the country, COVID-19 is on the rise once again. 46 states now seeing an uptick in cases. The Delta variant wreaking havoc nationwide. The CDC says the variant accounted for nearly 58% of new cases since July 3rd.
Whenever anyone has an increased risk or susceptibility to getting a case, their incidence for being hospitalized goes up. Then their chance of having severe disease goes up, and unfortunately, deaths can follow.
The death rate also up in the last week. Experts say more than 99% of the deaths in June were unvaccinated people.
It's disappointing and disheartening that we're literally seeing lives lost due to those who aren't getting vaxxed.
With transmission showing no signs of stopping, physicians in the hardest hit areas say the spread among young people is a big concern ahead of the school year. The CDC reports so far about 25% of 12 to 15 year olds are fully vaccinated.
Parents would like to have a situation where their children are as protected as they can be, but that requires everybody to do their part, wear masks when appropriate, and then get vaccinated.
The White House hoping to get a boost from pop star Olivia Rodrigo, all in hopes of encouraging young people to get that crucial shot in the arm. I'm Daryl Forges reporting.
Putting a national spotlight on what they deem Texas voter suppression laws, a Democratic-led effort to thwart an election overhaul bill from passing in a special session is continuing.
Right now, dozens of Democrats remain in D.C. They've been there since Monday, and they don't have a set timeline to return. Today, several members of the House and Senate Democratic caucuses held a press conference where they went into detail about the effort.
Yeah, they compare legislation we are seeing today to the era of Jim Crow laws taking over the South. Those on the other end of the spectrum, Republicans, say Democrats are wasting taxpayer money by not being present to do their job.
So it looks like when certain people start to make progress and start to participate, the rules change, which is what we're seeing 2021. When you see more young people, when you see counties coming up with creative ways to vote, 24-hour voting, drive-through voting, more people of color voting, more women of color, oh wait, we're going to change the laws.
Today, Texas House Speaker Dade Phelan released the following statement, saying in part, quote, Texas Democrats currently in Washington continue to collect their legislative per diem of $221 during regular and special sessions, which equates to hundreds of thousands of dollars during the course of this special session.
He says, quote, while these Texas Democrats collect taxpayer money as they ride on private jets to meet with the Washington elite, those who remain in the chamber await their return to begin work. Those who are intentionally denying quorum should return their per diem to the state treasury immediately upon receipt, end quote.
Coming up tonight at 6, we're going to be hearing from Republican State Representative Steve Allison. We'll be getting his thoughts on what's going on in this special session and if there's room for compromise. It's during our KSAT Q&A during the news at 6.
And testimony from 5 eyewitnesses today in what is now the third day of the trial of Otis McCain.
Some of the most compelling coming from a mother and daughter who saw the shooting of Detective Benjamin Marconi.
Erica Hernandez has been following this trial daily and has details from inside the courtroom today. Erica?
Yeah, Jennifer and Alexandria Patterson were visiting San Antonio on November 20th, 2016 for a birthday. They were actually heading to brunch when they noticed an SAPD patrol unit with its lights on and then a car approached behind. Now, both mother and daughter gave emotional testimony to the moments that happened next when they saw the man get out of the car and approach Detective Marconi's car with a gun.
Oh my God, Mom, he's got a gun. Mom, he's looking down. He doesn't know. That's why when we were taking the left and I saw the man get out with the gun, I started panicking and like, what the f- is he doing? Because I didn't know if we should honk, but then I thought maybe if he looked up, that wouldn't be helpful.
Now, after describing making eye contact with the suspect, Alexandria then identified that man in court as Otis McCain. Now, Alexandria was one of 3 witnesses to identify and point out the shooter as McCain in court today. Later at 6, we're going to hear from another witness to the shooting who actually was there seconds after it happened. Steve, Alicia.
Thank you, Erica. Now an update on a deadly crash we told you about yesterday. 3 people killed on the northwest side have been identified as 26-year-old Khalil Muhammad Howard, 22-year-old Angel Esteban Lozano, and 25-year-old Lorenzo Rey Fraga. Howard is from Atkins, Texas. Lozano is from Laredo, and Fraga is from Dallas. San Antonio police say all 3 were ejected from an SUV at the intersection of Babcock Road and Clear Rock Drive yesterday morning. A 4th person was taken to the hospital. No update on that person's condition.
We'll also learn the name of a man stabbed to death earlier this month. The Bexar County Medical Examiner has identified him as Genaro Tabora Luna. He died on July 4th in what San Antonio police describe as a heated argument between family members. They say a total of three people stabbed at a home in the 200 block of East Vestal Place. The 46-year-old, the only one who died.
And a 29-year-old man is in the hospital after he crashed into a light pole on the city's west side last night. It happened around 8:30 last night at the intersection of South Brazos and Guadalupe Streets. Witnesses told officers at the scene the driver was speeding before he ran a red light, hit an SUV, and then his car hit a light pole. Investigators say the man wasn't wearing a seatbelt and had to be cut from the vehicle. He was taken to the hospital and at last check was in critical but stable condition.
And Crime Stoppers needs your help in finding the person who shot and killed these two women back in May. This is 24-year-old Abranique Johnson and 26-year-old Reniqua Sims. Police tell us the two were leaving the Fourth Quarter Sports Bar on Wurzbach Road on May 29th. They were heading home when officers say suspects driving in another vehicle chased them and shot at the car, killing them both. If you have any information that can help police, you're asked to call Crime Stoppers at 224-224. STOP.
And San Antonio police are still investigating a shooting they're calling a random act of violence. It happened early this morning in the 4200 block of Chestnut Hill Drive. Police say the victim, a man in his 40s, was standing near a food trailer when a car carrying three people pulled up. They then fired at the man, hitting him once in the face. The man was taken to the hospital and is expected to be okay. Police are still looking for those responsible for the shooting.
San Antonio police are also investigating a crash overnight that actually involved one of their own. It happened just after 11 last night on Southwest Military Drive. That's near I-35 South. Police say a person riding a motorcycle ran a red light and rear-ended a marked patrol car. The officer wasn't injured, but the motorcyclist was taken to the hospital. They're expected to be okay. That crash is still under investigation.
Fairly quiet for most out there today, except right now we are starting to see a few of these sea breeze showers and thunder showers work their way into Bexar County and the surrounding areas. We've got some thunder going on and lightning going on between Stockdale and Nixon Smiley. And then in southern Bexar County, between 410 and 1604, a flash of lightning and some even heavier rain into the extreme southern part of the county. Now these are going to be moving in throughout the evening commute, and they'll be quick movers, but they could produce a quick half inch of rain in some spots. Other than that, it's warm, but not July hot outside. 84 in Lakey, 88 in Leon Springs, 86 in Floresville, and it's 89 in Universal City, as well as 86 in Mr. Bill's backyard in Helotes. An updated and in-depth look at that radar coming up in just a bit. And we'll continue this weather pattern of isolated showers each afternoon, but we'll keep the triple digits at bay. So got details for you in the forecast coming up in a bit. Steve?
Thank you, Sarah. Drought and extreme heat are fueling wildfires across the American West. In Oregon, the biggest wildfire in the country right now has already destroyed 200,000 acres. State of emergency has been declared in Doyle, California, as a fire there growing to more than 9,500 acres. Community members across both of those states have been working to collect supplies and offer housing to those whose homes were destroyed. In California, firefighters say they're seeing the type of fire behavior they've been training for. California has had only a quarter of the rain it would get in a normal year, and scientists expect the weather to get more severe as the world warms.
Summertime, it means spending more time outdoors, and for some, it also means sprucing up your space. If you're looking for a new outdoor rug, it's more than just choosing one with a good look. Which materials work best against rain, dirt, heat, and bacteria? Next.
Sprucing up your space.
Sprucing it up. If you can ignore the humidity, our sub-triple digit weather has made the outdoors kind of pleasant this summer. And that has folks spiffing up their outdoor spaces. An outdoor rug is an easy way to add style to the porch or patio. So 12 on your side's Marilyn Moritz looks at how to pick the right one and make it last.
An outdoor rug can make the space. There are plenty of weather-resistant options. So how do you know which ones are best? Jessica Bui transformed a dirt space with pavers and a rug.
It feels like an extension of my living room, in a sense. So it feels like it's a place to go and hang out.
How long a rug lasts depends on where you put it.
We consulted industry experts and found that there are big differences in how your rug will react with the type of surface it's placed on. And don't expect them to last a lifetime.
Unlike typical outdoor furnishings, outdoor rugs don't have a long lifespan, typically 3 to 7 years, shorter if it's humid. Besides sun fading, moisture can be the big enemy, causing mold and mildew, damaging the surface underneath.
Unless it's sealed, a concrete surface can be porous and become mildewed, and a rug placed on grass or wood will also trap moisture beneath.
When shopping, breathability matters. Look for rugs labeled polypropylene or olefin. It's the same plastic used in ropes and sportswear, and it resists fading and staining. Other synthetics like nylon, acrylic, and polyester tend to be more resilient than natural fibers like sisal and seagrass. The fabric borders will absorb water and can harbor fungi and bacteria, so they're best indoors. Whatever type rug you have, it will last longer if you occasionally hang it up and allow it to dry. Marilyn Moritz, KSAT 12 News.
You know, usually my outdoor decorating comes down to where should I put the cooler?
Yes, in the summertime.
Yeah, right? Spiffing it up. Yeah, that's really all I'm concerned about.
Hey,
but
look at that.
Look how dark those clouds are out there.
Yeah, we've got some rain. We've got some rain in the area, Steve and Alicia. Now, this is what's been happening the last several days. We get the sea breeze showers that bring in these thunder showers right in the peak heating of the afternoon. And unfortunately, this is going to make the evening commute for some folks a little bit wet and may have to take their time out there this evening. But for most of us, it's just going to help to keep things a little bit cooler for the outflow boundaries that are developing out there. So let's go ahead and take a look at some of these thunder showers that are developing. I'm calling them thunder showers because they're not severe. They're just producing some thunder and some lightning in areas. This is north of Stockdale in Wilson County. This is going to be heading due north. So areas like Seguin could end up, if this holds on, getting a quick splash and dash thunder shower. And then out just to the north of Pleasanton, we've got some heavier rain falling right along 37. So again, making the evening commute for some folks a little bit difficult. This is starting to move into Bexar County. Let's get into a neighborhood view. Anywhere you're seeing these lines here, these are flashes of lightning. So you can see that some of the lightning is even occurring outside of where the rain is out near Houston High School. And further inside of 410, we're seeing the heavier rain from about Boltville all the way to the Highland Park area, again along 37, and further on down to the south near Mitchell Lake, Buena Vista, at Mission San Juan, we're seeing some of the heavier rain as well, just outside of 1604 on the south side. And again, this is moving just about to the north-northwest. So Kirby area also getting a good, healthy downpour. This is going to be moving into downtown San Antonio here shortly. And again, not everybody's going to see rain, but I do believe that everybody should enjoy some rain-cooled air before we see the sun set. And once the sun sets, this is when we're going to see all of this start to die down. And it'll be a fairly quiet evening as it has been for the last few evenings with temperatures in the 70s, and it'll feel nice. Enjoy some time on the patio. Just a little bit muggy out there as it typically is this time of year. We're also seeing those clouds increase around San Antonio from the blow off from some of these thunder showers. Meanwhile, it's pretty sunny out near Kerrville, Bandera, and Sisterdale, and especially out to the west where temperatures this afternoon are in the mid-90s in Del Rio. 88 right now in San Antonio, but that temp's going to drop as soon as that outflow boundary moves through parts of where the sensor is near the airport. Look at this. 24 hours ago, we were about 10 to 20 degrees cooler because the rain came a little bit earlier in the day. And our afternoons are really going to be driven by these outflow boundaries and these showers. Coastal showers are going to develop every afternoon through the weekend. And notice that it's really just the coastal communities and into middle part of Texas that are dealing with the rain. All because this high is off to our east, it's directing our wind flow. And so every single day, we're going to have some coastal showers here. It's not going to rain everywhere, but there is a chance for isolated rain just about every day into the weekend. Speaking of the weekend, even though the temperatures are going to be cooler than seasonably average, we're still going to have a heat index value close to 100. So again, just cooler than average doesn't mean it's going to be cool. It's still going to be toasty. For your Thursday, waking up tomorrow, patchy fog, 75 degrees, clearing skies around noon. And then in the afternoon, it'll be mostly sunny, but we're likely going to have an isolated shower or an isolated thunder shower tomorrow afternoon. The weekend looks good for outdoor activities. Just keep the KSAT Weather Authority app handy if you have outdoor plans for a chance for a stray shower. And we'll tell you all about the Saharan dust moving in as well.
Thank you, Sarah. We'll be sure to keep those umbrellas handy.
Absolutely. All right. This is a huge game tonight, Greg.
Yeah. Can Milwaukee win two in a row at home, or do the Phoenix Suns steal one on the road going back home for game five? When we come back, the NBA Finals resumes tonight. And who are your 4A favorites in state, according to Texas Football Magazine, when we come back? The NBA Finals resume tonight live on KSAT 12. The Bucks try and get even with the Phoenix Suns in this best-of-seven series. One big advantage the Bucks tonight, besides playing at home, is that there have been 2 days in between Game 3 on Sunday night and now Game 4 tonight. What does the Bucks star Giannis Antetokounmpo think of the extra time off after hyperextending his knee in the Eastern Conference Finals, only to explode for back-to-back games of 40 or more points in the NBA Finals?
It's good for us, you know, mentally and physically, and for me also. I was like to have a little bit more time in between the games, you know, so I can get a little bit more rested, recover a little bit better, and, you know, be able to, you know, go and play hard.
The big question for the Phoenix Suns is, how do they stop the Greek Freak, who is averaging 41.5 points in the last two games? One reason why the Bucks are 4.5 point favorites tonight.
We're going to keep, you know, trying to build a wall. You know, he's coming full speed. Every play, you know, like a running back coming downhill. And, you know, coach has a saying, we just say we try to get in his way, you know, but he's able to do that because he's surrounded by some really good players too, you know, because you have Middleton out there on the wing, you got Lopez out there shooting it, and you got Drew Holiday and all these other guys. So we just going to keep, you know, stick with our game plan and see what we can do.
All right, and here's the matchup tonight for Game 4 in Milwaukee. Game 5 will be Saturday in Phoenix.
Pro football coverage, powered by Davis Law Firm.
NFL free agent cornerback Richard Sherman has been arrested and booked into jail for burglary, domestic violence in the Seattle area. That's according to ESPN. That says police received a 911 call from a resident that said an adult member was trying to force his way into a house he does not live in. Sherman spent the last three seasons with the 49ers. There's been talk of the Cowboys signing Sherman as a player and assistant coach, but that's before he's facing felony charges that could be on hold. We continue our Dave Campbell's Texas High School football rankings. We've already covered 6A and 5A preseason state favorites. Now it's time to check in on Class 4A. That's where we find the Bernie Greyhounds, the highest ranking Class 4A division, one in the San Antonio area, with as many as 13 players returning to the team, including punter Rashawn Galloway, who's named to the preseason All-State team. In Class 4A Division 2, the Wimberley Texans are number 3 in the state with 14 starters, returning to a team that finished 12-4 last year and made it all the way to the state semifinals. So here's how it stacks up at the 4A top 25. It'd be Bernie and Canyon Lake in Division 1 at 15-21. Division 2, Wimberley, Quero, and Navarro. We'll see you on the late edition of the Night Beat tonight.
Yep. After game 4.
You got it.
Yeah. Thanks, Greg.
Thank you. All right.
We'll be right back. We'll be right back.
Thunder showers are moving into San Antonio as we speak. Brief heavy rain and a few flashes of lightning, but no severe weather. And we'll have a chance for isolated afternoon rain tomorrow as well as through the weekend. It'll feel hot during the weekend with heat index values close to 100 degrees. More on that radar coming up at 6.
Thanks for watching the news at 5.
World News is up next. We'll see you back here at 6 o'clock.